Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Warsaw, Poland for the Wargaming.net League Grand Finals. This is where it is at Carmack, and I tell you what, Na'Vi, they really know how to bring it.
Yeah, they do. They seem unstoppable so far. But right now, it's going to be another hot game, another do-or-die game for Lemming Train, and this time it's against Red Rush Unity.
Yeah, we'll have to see if we go to that one straight away. But obviously, these two teams were the ones that came out of the groups. So they've made it this far, and it just goes to show, you know, what it required for them to get out of the groups and how they're carrying it through. So, of course, Lemming Train, they wouldn't be too happy about, obviously, the last game they played. But it's Na'Vi, come on. And they were, for anyone, I think they're going to be just as unstoppable. But we'll have to wait and see. We're going to hand it over to our experts now just to break things up for you guys, or break it down, should I say, and give us a bit more of an idea of where we're at.
Thank you, Mitch and Carmack. We're going to break it down, break it up, put it all together, and build the house that esports has built here live in Warsaw, Poland. I'm Joshua Clutchgray, joined by Mr. Mojo to my far right from the Casa Crew, Wilkie from Free Fall, Magus from TCM, and the very lovely Melly Melly. I'm sure a lot of people were chiming in about their thoughts on that last matchup of Na'Vi versus Lemming Train.
It was amazing. Well, Na'Vi is really experiencing a lot of support from the community. I mean, they're the World of Tanks team, one of the very first professionals we had in this community, and it's really nice to see how people support their own people, and it's really cool. If you want to see yourself, just head over to Twitter and check out the hashtag The Grand Finals, and you'll see all the posts regarding this beautiful event. And yeah, what else to say to that matter, right?
It is a wonderful event, and Carmack and Uber have been talking about it multiple times in front of a fantastic crowd.
Exactly.
It has been sold out here. Well, it's free to get in, but every seat has been taken for multiple games here, especially to cheer on Lemming Train. And out here in the foyer, we see many, many people gathering together, watching one of the screens here. Actually, a couple people burst into song, I think, a couple times over some of the victories. That's been fun to see.
That's true. We have a social media tool implemented into the venue that we haven't mentioned it yet, but we have a photo booth standing right here on site for all the audience that's with us here in this lovely venue. You can just head over in the foyer. There is a booth. You can stand in front of a Wargaming wall and get your picture taken and upload it to the WGL, if I can use my words, WGL Global Twitter account. And it's like cemented into the internet, since you know what's ever been on the
it's
internet.
It's there forever. It's
exactly.
Never
you
going
never
away.
Going away. Never.
Just like tournament results. It's never
internet
going
that
away. That's right. Well, I actually want to take the time to thank each and every one of you that have joined me on the desk this weekend. And I have to say, English is my first language. For everyone here, it's not your first language. And I know the struggles sometimes of that doublethink that it happens. And I've been impressed with each and every one of you, the talent so far, and also the players that want to communicate to the world. And that's why we made the choice to broadcast in English. But if English is not your first language, we have multiple languages being broadcasted right now. For the tournament, we have Russian, Chinese, Korean. And am I missing one? Do we have another one that's going
Polish.
Out to the world?
Polish
as well. Yes, of course.
Yes.
Of course, for the home team here. And this is my first time in Warsaw, and so far we received a fantastic welcome. Gentlemen, the battle is going to take place, Lemming Train versus Red Rush Unity. The winner continues. The loser goes home.
Yeah.
Stakes are high. Lemming Train, the team that has performed the most on this stage, I think they brought their sling bags and their cots to stay here. Are they fatigued? Is this too many matches for a team in one weekend? Is this going to start to be a role for them that maybe they've played too many matches so far, or is it the opposite? Does it give them energy to continue?
Actually, I think Lemming Train has played more matches than Unity, because they went to the loser bracket in the Group A, and Unity stayed in the winner's bracket all the time. So I don't think so. They're the home time boss. They are all the time cheered. So I think it's even better for them that they're playing more and more games.
That is one of the biggest storylines that we have here at this tournament, is this wild card team. It was an invitational. We had two wild card teams. They were third place in EU, and now they have performed, I think, beyond most people's expectations.
And I would definitely say their loss from Na'Vi would be even beneficial for them, because it will lower their expectation and bring them back to ground.
Oh, yeah,
they
sure.
know hard work is ahead. it's not unknown that a team from a loser bracket comes back to the finals, and I'm really with all heart hoping I will see that. My mind says Navi is dominant, but heart follows Lemming Train, definitely.
And one interesting fact is actually that both of these teams were dropped out by a similar playstyle, Virtus Pro and Navi. They both play pretty similar playstyle.
Well, looking at the stats overall for these teams, let's talk a little bit, Magus, about how they perform in EU. Are they kind of the wild card all the time? Are they ones that develop strategies that are maybe unique? Or is it kind of they play standard but not as well as other teams?
No, Lemming Train definitely also developed tactics. They're trying to figure out positions on every map. And I would say they are one of the better teams in Europe as well to figure out positions. So after the Russians, I think they are the team that do most new tactics or different ways to play a tactic in Europe. So they're pretty, creative.
One thing they've got to work on, though, is definitely that accuracy, yeah. As we saw in the stats. Yeah. But, again, pressure, the lack of lag, of latency, hopefully, is such a value to, or a parameter to really kind of think about, because some teams, some members of teams, such as Antonio Handsome and Fnatic, his ping is way different since he's playing from Spain compared to some of these teams that are playing at more closer proximity. They have to make those adjustments. And when they go to a LAN event, they go to a live event, they don't have to make those adjustments, so their play style shifts just a little bit. And that's part of the experience of playing here live. It is a different environment. All right, so that's Lemming Train, folks. We've talked about them a lot. And Carmen has talked about himself a lot as well. He's a great guy.
He'd like to talk, yeah.
He does. He does. So do I. That's why I'm here. All right, Red Rush Unity, the next team. Renault. That damage he's been able to output in a lot of these different games, over 3K, is phenomenal. They need to keep that damage up if they're going to continue on the warpath that we've seen from them. Their opponents maybe not as strong compared to Lemming Train, and I think this is going to be probably the biggest match of the week for them so far.
Yeah, it's definitely the biggest test for them now, but I think Lemming Train have to stay up now after the loss against Navi. They have to fully focus on the next game. I hope that they don't drop into a hole and say, okay, no, we lost. And they have to directly say, okay, Navi was the last game. Now we focus on the next game against Unity. And I think Unity had the same after they lose against Virtus Pro. I mean, it was really close game, 3-2. And then they were a bit lucky. They had to fight an Asian team. It's a bit weaker than Navi compared to Lemming Train. And now they are back into the tournament, and I think that's slightly in favor for Unity that they're already on the winning streak again.
That's true, but then you look, as you mentioned, the Asian teams they had to compete against. You Are Dead, NOA, twice. Yeah. NOA showed them a couple surprises, but
they shook him up a bit.
A little bit, and then it can kind of, I don't want to talk about false confidence, because any confidence is fantastic, but when you have an arrogant confidence, if you're not grounded, like maybe Lemming Train just experience, you're thinking, we got this, guys. We don't need to discuss tactics. Let's go to lunch. We don't need to do this. We don't need to do that. We're on a winning streak. And that's really, really, really dangerous. Your biggest successes can also be your biggest weaknesses. And I feel that could be the case of Red Unity. But since they're an experienced team and they've been in multiple tournaments and they've fought very, very hard teams in the past, I don't think that's going to be the case here. But it's anybody's guess. It's anybody's game. Here we are for the map vetoes and then the map choices. Two representatives from Red Rush Unity, one from Lemming Train. Only two this time, not three, as we saw
yesterday. The numbers are decreasing constantly.
Yeah, we got to get that ice cream here pretty soon, fellas.
Yeah, going closer to the final.
Yeah, we are.
To do wonders for my voice, I think.
yeah, huge shout out to Mr. Mojo. He unfortunately caught cold here in Poland, but he is a trooper, staying with us on the desk. Ruinberg, the first veto.
Yeah.
Still thinking.
These teams might not want to play steps, so we might see just another step span.
An update for you guys regarding PvP Super Friends and Arete. I believe they were tied up 2-2. Not sure on the final verdict of that series, but the winner goes on to play Fnatic, I believe. Cliff is the second veto. Still a possibility to see steps.
Yeah. I mean, Unity is really strong on Cliff, so it's was a really obvious option for Lemming Train to bend Cliff.
I just received an update. PvP Super Friends defeated Arete 3-2. They will move on to face Fnatic. That man lives.
We need to get that.
Quite sure. I'm quite sorry I didn't see the match.
No. Oh, really? I think we need the light. The light.
Bat signal?
Yeah, bat signal.
We'll work on that.
We need to
we'll
work
on
the song to
Batman. Cliff and Ruinberg, the two vetoes, still waiting for the fifth map. It is Steps. Surprise, surprise. No. But we'll see what else they can bring.
And it's going fast, Matt.
All right.
So two open maps and one city map left for the last three.
Prohorovka, maybe the first map is going to get chosen. We get to see some fast firefighting happening between these two.
I think Mainz will be the first again. I think Prohorovka is third, Himmelsdorf second.
Prohorovka is third.
Yeah.
Good call, Magnus. That's why we got you here.
Yeah, sometimes I'm on the right side.
I know. Sometimes I'm right, and I hate being right sometimes. You know, it's kind of tough as a commentator. Yeah. See these different teams, like, oh, they're going to push, and it's not going to work, and then it happens.
Yeah.
Still waiting for the final two maps, looks like. Lemming Train just sent in the confirmation.
Himmelsdorf,
Mainz, nailed it. Nice work. Want to mention as well, ladies and gentlemen, that every time there is a draw, the Blitz pool increases, which is a separate prize pool. The team that has the fastest match will receive that pool of money. And I believe so far, Lemming Train is in the lead. With
Lemming Train, 250.
Yep. 250. And that was up against Arete, who pushed up against him.
Yes,
all right. It was Mainz that was the first map, correct, gentlemen?
Yeah.
Mainz, Himmelsdorf, Prohorovka, Ensk, and Steps. The illustrious Steps. Yeah. Has anybody played on Steps yet? Have you seen anyone in the foyer play on Steps?
Yeah, some guy was playing on the public.
Oh. Oh, okay. That doesn't count.
Last time I saw Steps play seriously was in finals in Tihi, Season 3 Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Navi. Virtus against Synergy, it was a big clash and it ended it within like 2 minutes, something like that. And I'm 100% we will not see such situation here.
Best of seven. Best of seven, I feel that Steps will be the first map played. And it might draw out. But we'll see. Anything is possible between these teams. Looking at history of Red Rush Unity versus Lemming Train, the plays, you talk about the Intercontinental, Russia versus EU. Do they have a history? Is there a history between these two teams?
Only on the weekly and monthly cups. Unity was in the first season, I think, sixth place. So they didn't participate in the Continental Clash. They were really on the down in the first season. They basically just qualified for the offline event and then ended in sixth place, I think, if I remember right. But then the second season, they ended offline and online second, directly behind Navi, and the same for the third season. So they improved really a lot from the first season.
Definitely. Definitely. It's great to see the type of improvement from any of these teams in their separate regions. I feel that maybe some of these teams are going to start competing against each other and maybe start kind of forming alliances a bit here in the different regions. How do we beat the best team? Well, let's work together.
Yeah, that could be an option. Yeah. I mean, a lot of teams training together to do it. And they're doing also European with Russian teams, Russian with North American with European teams. So we're trying to improve, share information and tactics to just get better.
That's how people improve. There's Carmen talking to the rest of his team. They just suffered a loss against Na'Vi. Now we're waiting for all the team members to be completely set up here.
Come on, guys, we can do it. Drink Red Bull, drink two, just play.
Don't worry about the RNG.
I think Carmen would say you have to move on your feet home. You don't will fly if you lose.
Yeah.
Something like that. That's Carmen's style.
It's great to see the history of these teams in this amalgamation, in this kind of climax of a lot of hard work for each of them. And a lot of teams have been participating in the Bronze League, the Silver League that we have over in North America. I believe you gentlemen in your different regions have similar leagues, kind of the amateur leagues.
There's something like A series and they have three divisions.
Yeah. Have you seen teams from those series build themselves up into the Gold League in your respective regions?
Freefall.
WUSA.
And WUSA, yeah.
There was a number of teams that had done that in Season 3 that joined us for the first time in the Gold League, and they made it to the finals, which was quite impressive. And it was very important overall for the entire region to see that if a team could form, had good leadership, good strategy, and a little bit of creativity, that they could earn some serious cash. And that invitation is continually open to any team that wants to begin to participate. If you're in North America or the different regions, simply go to worldoftanks.com to get more information about how you can sign up.
Grab some friends.
Roster.
You have to play with me.
Yeah. Roster of 10 is what we have. Seven are the ones that play. And you start earning some gold in the game, which is a great incentive because you get better at the tanks when you can play different styles of tanks. We can obviously add camouflage to your tanks, which when I first started playing tanks, I go, oh, camo actually adds a value that's good in the game. It's not just for looks.
I'd say start with team battles.
Yes.
It's a game mode, definitely. And people can get a perspective what that format looks like, and they can even meet really good teams there. Often some even pro teams just play for fun, or they make pug mix and then just also play for fun, and you can really learn a lot even getting that really fast.
Yeah, it's really easy to get into it, and you also can grind your crew in the 742 format mode. It's really cool.
You get a lot of XP playing in that mode. If you win, yeah, of course, if you win, of course. I played a lot of the public modes as well, and also tank companies, which, you know, if you have a lot of people, you get to work together, or you can platoon, get two of your friends and play the different tanks. Tier 8, you guys would agree it's the most balanced tanks, pretty
much. Definitely.
Yeah, for sure.
When I first got the T110 E5 and I unlocked it, I went, yes, I finally got it. And it really was not penetrating other Tier 10 tanks. I'm going to go back to the T32. This is really not working for me. I'm currently working on the T69, but I have a sheriff account as well. I get to play with a lot of the fans in the game. All the pro players, the pro teams have that as well, and we get to interact with the fans. And that's what really makes it all possible. It's the players that play to their best, that dedicate their lives pretty much to becoming the best they can be. And it's the fans that support them, either with time, viewership, purchasing products, supporting the teams, supporting the sponsors that sponsor the teams. And that's how the ecosystem continues to grow here. And a lot of people have been exposed to what World of Tanks esports is all about, especially with the thousands that have been watching us on Twitch so far in multiple languages. Again, folks, it looks like we were giving Lemming Train a little bit of a break after that matchup, and it's well deserved, obviously. So we're just waiting for them to make final confirmation that they're ready to go. I want to talk a little bit more about TCM while we got you here, Magus. Okay. Rare opportunity to have you here. What's the history of the team? What was your inclination, your drive to join the team to play World of Tanks? And how can teams form and compete? What is the process? What was the process like for you?
I started short after the beta. My brother was playing the game, and I thought, I don't want to play, I want to play, I was not sure about it. Then a few friends of mine also started, and then, okay, let's do it, give it a try, and joined it. And then, yeah, I came into ESL because I was playing other games also in ESL, and there was a German local EPS, so just a Nation Cup. And, yeah, I called the friends, guys, tomorrow we have the qualifier, be ready, we want to play. And then, yeah, my career started. We participated in the first season, we won the qualifier, and then everything continued. And I think in 2012, short before Christmas, I joined Team Odomortis. We qualified immediately, I think 2 weeks later, for Katowice Intel Extreme Masters event last year. And yeah, since then I'm in the team. We had a short trip with Dragon Bones for season one. Then we decided, okay, it's not working together. And now we're happy to, yeah, playing for TCM Gaming. Really cool guys, really nice support from them. And yeah, hoping for the next season to go back to the grand finals, or the finals, and then also to the grand finals.
Yeah, and this is the first grand finals that World of Tanks has hosted, that Wargaming has hosted. Phenomenal event so far, gentlemen. You look at the daunting task of trying to put a league together. Okay, how can we invite the best of the best? How can we organize this? What rule set do we use? What is 7x42? How can we express the necessary parameters to make this fair for all people? How do we do it in multiple languages and multiple regions? Do we have region locks? How does this work? And I've been working in the realm of esports for a number of years, in the realm of entertainment for even longer than that. And I have to say, I'm very, very impressed approach that Wargaming has brought to World of Tanks with the coordination between the different regions. And even though we have different flavors and some cultural differences when it comes to rule sets compared to draws and shootouts, I have to say that we will honestly crown a champion at this event for the entire world and for the entire world to look up to. And that's very, very important.
I would say this is really ever-changing game. It brings through the patches a lot of interesting moments. Recently, a friend of mine, they didn't play for a year. He logged on and, oh, let's play a bit, okay. And after like 5 minutes, you can fall from a hill. What is happening?
Yeah. The physics.
The physics. Then we played some new map, and one tank was running on us, and he jumped over some canal, and like in cartoon, he didn't make it to the other side, he just hit the wall, and he fell down. And I see my friend dying, and what's going on? Sorry, mate, I was laughing so hard, I couldn't play.
Yeah, and I can't wait for the Havoc engine.
Oh, me too. I was at the Game Developers Conference,
okay,
where the Wargaming USA office was there, and I got to speak to the Havoc gentleman about how the engine works, how it's going to improve World of Tanks, and a lot of the benefits will be, obviously, for us as players, but also for the audience. They will see the amazing physics, the amazing display of you know, you shoot a building and it doesn't just crumble down, the bricks fly, and I feel that adds a certain intensity that's necessary to make the game even better.
Also changed the meta totally, I think, also for the esports part, because yeah, tank bricks are movable now, and they have turret fly up, and you can use them as cover,
yeah.
You can shoot buildings, and yeah, it's totally new meta, I think.
I am really interested, when that turret falls down on a tank, even a
damage.
Friendly tank,
yeah.
What happens if you kill your own tank with your turret that just fell from the sky?
That's the worst RNG that could ever happen to your team, probably.
More talk for Carmen.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, more fodder for Carmen to complain about. The thing that I also am impressed with is that Wargaming wanted to create a game that was accessible to so many different people with different types of computer hardware. And that's why they have, you know, kind of kept the graphics at a way that you can change the quality of the graphics. And now with the Havix engine coming out and the improved graphics for the game, it's going to look even better on these super awesome machines. And the audience is such a huge factor to think about when it comes to esports. Because if we're just doing this just for us guys, well, it's you, me, Melly, a couple guys enjoying some beers in the foyer, and that's it. And then a whole crowd out there. But when you can kind of break down, okay, we're going to make a game that is competitive and fun to watch. There's so many different elements that goes into that that can make it daunting, that can make it difficult, that people have been trying to figure it out for years. And Wargaming in their first freshman run for the first season has done a very good job of it. And testament right there, as you can see on the screen, is
well,
all these people.
The same changes
enjoying.
As the game changes. You have patches that affect physics, gameplay. Esports change also.
Yes.
In the start, they were not so attractive to watch. It was hard. You had a lot of draws. But then people say, okay, this is not working. Let's change it. And you can see now. After a draw on a map, you go on the next one. Everyone gets a point. That's kind of punishment sometimes.
And that's how it works. The evolution continues. Things change. Things improve. And now we're going to see who has improved the most so far between Red Rush Unity and Lemming Train. The match is almost ready. It's time to throw it over to the commentators.
Thank you very much, Clutch. Now we are going to see one of the most exciting games again. And this is Lemming Train's last chance. They have to take out Unity. Unity, people could argue that they had a lighter group than people expected. They went against inexperienced teams compared to the other group. Now they have going to be tested by a team that took out Synergy. They're like, well, I say a team very similar in some respects. What do you think?
Some teams were telling me that they thought that Unity had underperformed in their group. And with the way that Lemming Train has been performing, I think Lemming has a slight edge. Of course, Lemming seems to be getting kind of tired. They were talking earlier, a Clutch on the analysis desk was talking earlier about how they've been on stage the most out of any team. Now, they haven't played the most matches. Unity has played a number of matches as well, but these guys have got to be getting tired by now.
No, I think they played more matches because of the loser brackets.
Well, they played more matches, just not on stage.
Okay.
On the
well,
main
anyway,
stage.
We are going into Mines for the first battle here. It is a best of five, so they have to win three games to go through. So this is a big upward challenge here for Lemming Train. Can they outsmart Unity? They have the experience advantage, Unity, as a team. They've been together for a bit longer. But as you said, this event, well, it doesn't matter what experience you've got in the past. This event, Lemming Train are looking a lot stronger. So let's get into the fight. Lemming Train versus Unity. Give it up. And we are going into game number one on Mines. We've seen some epically fast, aggressive games on Mines so far. But will we see it this time?
Well, maybe not yet. I'm seeing number of blue players from Lemming Train are not moving.
I think that's a crash on your screen, sir.
Is it a crash on my screen? Because they're running into T1s.
It seems to be something going wrong here, and I'm not entirely sure.
Well, we apologize for any technical issues that may happen. We'll probably jump out of battle. Everyone will regame.
Oh,
and after that, we'll get this started.
Everyone was ready for that?
I was ready.
I think the entire crowd was ready. Who was ready for that? Because I was ready for that battle. It was, going to be... We can see the tanks, though. What tanks were those?
They've just jumped out, so...
The object...
I saw an object 416.
Saw
and 416. I saw two WZ-132s.
And that was Unity's.
The blue team was...
It was Unity's
no,
team.
No, blue team was Lemming.
It was Unity team. Unity
was
had
it?
The WZ-132. For sure. 100% certain. So they are going for an object and WZs. This is crazy. This is a crazy lineup. We've never seen it at all.
Yeah. they must have been going for the hill. Like, that's the only thing I can think of with WZ-132s. If rushing the water doesn't seem that effective to me, rushing the east side would be just an off strat you could bring with WZs, I guess. But the hill, you're getting that early damage and you're just trying to alpha down any 1390 that would try to fight you on there.
Yeah, indeed. It looks like one of the Unity players had disconnected or something like that, so that's what went wrong. But absolute crazy line. We've never seen that lineup before. An Object, 416, and two WZs on mines. Have you seen that before?
I've seen two WZs before, but I don't think I've ever seen two WZs and an Object 416. It's a very strange lineup. It's very light. WZs have a little bit less health than the 1390. They do great damage output. The DPM's a little low in the 100mm cannon, but the 85 is just disgusting damage output consistently.
So you think they're going for an aggressive play on the hill? They were north spawn, I believe. No, they were south spawn. So actually, I have no idea what they got up their sleeve. Unity are playing a strategy I am unfamiliar with completely.
Well, if you go with the south spawn, you can get a bad spawn that will make it they'll make your jump to the hill rather poor, and you might get there so late that you would just lose any tank going up. But if they spawn far enough to the west, they could get the right jump, and they could take the hill at the exact same time as the north, because I think the north has a slightly better jump to get the hill control. However, the south isn't exactly out of the running. It's just spawn-based.
Well, let's have a look what Lemming Train picked up. They did pick an IS-3, and I believe it was a T-32, and a Pershing. So a very... Okay, I'm not entirely sure of the tank, because we have to move on from that. We don't have the exact details of what tanks they have. Well, we'll start again in a second. But going back to mines, mm-hmm. we have seen T-32s used in the past. T-32s go in there, and they set up on the bottom of the hill, and they play a slow game there. But we've also seen the ultra-fast aggressive tactics of Fnatic, who completely destroyed their opponents by just driving up the hill and destroying them one by one.
Well, their opponent also was driving up the hill the same way. It's just they brought the T-69s, Fnatic. And that helped them on the hill, because they took a little damage early on. I can't remember what tank made that shot, but it is very easy from the north to get a bead on any tank entering the hill from the south. That's one of the things that people consider it to be a disadvantage when you're trying to take the hill from the south.
From the north side, I actually remember there's a position over around D1 or D2. If you go there at the start with a slower heavy tank, even the TDs can get there early. You can look across and you have full vision of the ramp going up. And you can get a good singular shot off, which can even track people who don't think they can be tracked as they're going up the hill. That's a dangerous position that I didn't know existed until it happened to me. And I was like, hey, what? Yeah. And I have so rarely seen that position used, because the drawback is you're not in position. But you can use your slower tanks differently. There are so many different ways to use slow tanks on mines. As you said, hashtag no cons for the T-32.
Exactly.
But, you know, they are still liable to be out of bad spawn, as you said. Could mean that you're a second late, and 1 second is all you need for a win or a loss, especially on mines.
And that's if you make the mistake of thinking that you can take your heavy tanks and just rush straight up. You have to take a little slower and just bully your opponent out of position if you're going to have the heavier lineup. If you bring IS-3s, T-32s, Pershings and the like to mines, you can really bully a lighter lineup with these WZs and Object 416. They can't just sit there and brawl with these tanks. They can maybe try and burst them down, but there's a huge health pool there, and there's plenty of armor. You're going to bounce at least one or two, because your opponent knows how to angle their armor. They know how to position themselves.
That is true. We have to look at the heavy lineup, if it is a heavy lineup there for Lemming Train, but who's got the advantage? Lemming Train or Unity have got the advantage here when they've got this delay. Because of the crazy tactic, what I believe is a crazy tactic from Unity, is that Lemming Train's advantage? Like, okay, we can think about this. Or, because they've seen Lemming Train's lineup, do Unity have an advantage to be able to think, right, how can we use this lineup against that lineup? Because it is pretty fragile, their lineup.
Exactly. This lighter lineup might have some trouble catching their opponent off guard. They had mostly light tanks, and their opponent had so much armor and health that I've seen this in the past. I've seen where teams actually, there was a team in the NA League that brought IS-6s because they reload a little faster. There's not much penetration on the APCR rounds in the IS-6, but it actually does put out more damage per minute than an IS-3. And they just drove at their opponent. And the thing is, they were using T-69s and stuff. T-69s are kind of ineffective against...
And the lower caliber, the AMX-1390 with the lower caliber gun, which some people do take on mines, and a WZ would pretty much counter them. You can't take the 110 because the size is still vulnerable. But the IS-6, what are you going to do?
Yeah, the lower caliber gun on the 1390, I don't think we've seen it here at our World Finals. And I feel like it's one of those things that, at least I think, isn't viable. It's one of those, you have to play so perfectly with those 1390s, and your opponent has to play into your hands. If your opponent just doesn't go to the hill and is like, oh, you brought that 75 mil? Great. I'm just going to not go to the hill, and we're going to fight when I'm loaded, and then just run over you. Because that 75 doesn't have enough damage in the clip to deal with many tanks.
True. But then again, many things that people say isn't viable, to me, when I hear that, I mean... It's not viable in a standard traditional battle, in a setup. I always think these things have a special thing they could do or a special situation where they'll be effective.
To clarify, I think it's more like there are more viable options. There's better ways to do the same thing. You can bring WZ-132s, and I think you'll just play better than that 75 mil on the 1390.
That's a fair point. I believe it's gone out of fashion anyway. The 1390 for a while was always being equipped on mines, especially with a lower caliber gun. But let's get back into it. Let's get hyped for Lemon Tree versus Unity as they're ready to go. All technical issues are fixed and we are ready for this matchup. It is Mines, the first map of this best of five. Let's see who can do it. Let's look at these tanks.
It is an Object 416, T69, 1390, and two WZ-132s.
Wow.
Yeah, I know, right?
But even more well, I see the IS-3s on mines. I just don't see that happen very often. That this is part of the meta. I think both these teams have destroyed the meta that is traditional to World of Tanks, and they've gone for something crazy to defeat their opponent.
The shot's fired, but no connections on the entrance. No, Rhino does take a hit on the entrance still. Carmen is on the way up.
But
and Snip is on the way
of
the G1.
And he goes down immediately. The focus fire takes down Elian right at the start. That is a horrendous start for Lemming Trainers. He was completely caught out. And Carmen's caught out for one shot against Rhino. What happened? And Snip. That's all the team basically is destroyed. All their vision is gone. All their map control is gone. And Elian is gone in the first 50 seconds. What happened there?
Elian just YOLO'd over the middle. I do not understand what he was thinking. He just went straight forward with no real support. The ice
weren't
there. But
the damage is coming back out, and Dino gets focused down to 400 HP. Another big shot, and he could go down, but Nuclear is coming round the back, and it's going to be scary for their opponents as Butcher is a one shot, and Nuclear will come round and get the shot, and he goes down. This is a big trouble for Lemon Train, and they're down to three combat tanks, but they are still on a lot of HP. If they can focus someone down, they might be able to get out of it, but they're down another tank as their IS-3s are completely destroyed. They're down to their Pershing, who's retreating at full speed. There's not much he can do now as the HP difference is just too big. And his support 1390 is on reload. What can Lemon Train do?
It's got to be hopeless at this point. I don't know what they were trying to accomplish with that outlook. Lemon Train doesn't look... This isn't the same team we were seeing earlier today and yesterday.
Fatigue must be coming in here, or it was just a misplay by Elian. He misread the opponents or something. He must have had a plan in mind, and it just didn't go right. But here's the Persian taking another shot there. 583 HP left. Nuclear is going in there, trying to get the shot, but it's not gonna matter. His team is getting around the back, and there's nowhere to hide.
Yeah, I want to actually return to a point just for a second. There are 85 mils on these WZ-132s, so their strat is definitely to go for the DPM on these tanks.
So it's DPM for these, it's sustained combat for these tanks. But Potomaco is down, and that is the last hope, really, the big DPS. He's going to ram the Antelage, doing a ton of damage. One more shot could finish him off, but I believe the reload is going to happen, and he's going to finish off. Unity takes game one on mines. Ouch.
Easily. That was easy for them.
That hurts.
Lemming Train really just gave them that battle.
What did Elian do?
He drove straight over. I don't really understand. I don't understand what he did. It's got to be a
Carmen's
mistake.
Look at Carmen's face.
Yeah.
Those eyebrows could actually be touching his lower cheekbones right now. He is upset, to say the least. And Elian doesn't seem that bothered. I think he is laughing, actually. I think he was like, okay, I messed up. Sorry, guys. I think that must have gone over the comms. Yeah. It's like, okay, we've done this. I'm sorry. Let's win the next map.
Yeah, just little mess-ups, but that...
A little mess-up.
Do you think that... Well, he thinks it is.
He didn't fire a shot, did he? No, he didn't
No, he didn't get a chance to. He just went straight over.
He went straight over and just got focused down against such a high burst damage team in the sense of the Object 416 get a hit. Both the WZs will get the shot.
The WZs were up on the hill by that time. But it was the 416 and the T69. Between those
The T69 was reloaded. Yeah,
The T69 is loaded, and the one shot from the Object 416 is sufficient.
Yeah, well, the Antlish did 2,156 damage. He was driving the Object 416. That tank, I've never seen used that effectively on mines, but then again, I just didn't understand what Lemon Train had done.
It's a damage monster. This is one of the highest DPM tanks in the game right now at Tier 8. It's absurdly effective. It has some cons to it. It just requires a bit of finesse.
Well, let's go through some theory crafting right now, because the Lemon Train have been fighting here for a lot of days, and a lot of battles, and a lot of these teams, like Unity, can watch their battles and see how they've been playing. Now, maybe they think, well, our strategies might be a bit stale, we have to do something crazy. Mm-hmm. And they're deciding to, instead of playing their standard tactics well, they're going to think of something new. Like, hey, let's pick IS-3s for mines. Yeah, that'll catch them off guard, because it's not done. But there's a reason why it's not done, and it didn't work out for them.
They didn't make the shots on the entrance to the hill. That was one thing that I noticed. Both IS-3s were in position, though. They were in position. They were lined up. And when the tanks that entering the hill, the WZ-132s, were finally lit, they just didn't take the hits. If those had landed, there would have been a WZ-132 at a one-shot to almost anything.
Yeah, that's exactly what they were trying to do. Mm-hmm. But it didn't.
Yeah, they would have
just didn't.
Following that, they would have been able to bully their opponent out of position if they decided to, but just things didn't work out. It was really just the alien mistake.
So going back into the theory crafting, do you think they should go back to their standard tactics and just play them well, or continue just playing out of their own comfort zone to try and fool their opponent out of their comfort zone? And see, that's a double-edged sword. Mm-hmm. You're not playing it as well, and your opponent doesn't necessarily know what you're doing, but against a team like Unity, who have been so adaptable, they've taken on many teams who have been crazy throughout their time. The Russian League has been crazy at periods of time with, I believe, they had KV-1Ss at one point being brought to battles and victories with them, I must add.
It hits hard, just as hard as an IS-3, it's just the reload.
They've seen some really strange stuff, so they've learned and adapted, and I'm not sure if cheese tactics, I think I would call them special tactics, I'm not sure if that's the way to go. If they need to play more standard, trust in what they've been doing, they've won some amazing matches against Synergy, against Simp. Why can't they just play that sort of games?
This has got to be one of those back pocket strats. You know, you're saying, let's be more aggressive, let's pull something different than what anyone's seen, and you hold on to those strats.
Yeah.
If you plan to make it to the end, you know that everyone's seeing your strategies, they're talking about them, they're studying them. So you have to have something ready against a team like Red Rush Unity, who is performing rather well, but they're not performing as well as Na'Vi has or anything, so maybe you can catch them off guard with something like this.
Well, that's exactly it. I want to point out about Na'Vi. We saw Lemon Train versus Na'Vi last time, and Na'Vi did very well playing standard tanks. They didn't really play anything unique. Inscrims were a bit special, but it wasn't unique. Now, Na'Vi are one of these teams that play standard throughout the whole tournament, maybe struggle at a few points, and everyone thinks, oh, well, they're not so strong, they could be taken. And then, when it hits their final battle, the final finals, they pull out these pocket strats. These pocket strats have never been seen before, and 3-0 their opponents.
Yeah, Na'Vi's done that a number of times in the
every
past.
Single for grand finals of their leagues. And this is the sort of thing you're talking about. Lemon Train realize they're on their last legs now, though, and then they're pulling out everything they've got, maybe, from their back pocket to see if they can stay in and reach the final day, because if they win here, I believe that's it for them today, and they will be here tomorrow, but if they lose, they're out. And that's a big thing.
Yeah, they've already lost one going to loser bracket, and it's going to be Himmelsdorf next, or is it going to be, it's going to be Ensk next, sorry.
Getting it's Himmelsdorf, Winter Himmelsdorf is Winter the next map, then Prokhorovka, then Ensk, and maybe Steps if it goes that far. Now, if it's going to ever go to the fifth map, it's going to be this matchup. They are pretty evenly matched up on paper, but the Unity just looked so much stronger in the first map. I've never seen Lemon Train play like that before, like ever. That was uncharacteristic.
I'm wondering if we're going to see WZ-132s again, because it's a nice tank, and we're seeing a few of them here and there. But they could make a comeback. It's a great DPM time. It's a great scout. And I thought I saw for a moment someone over here in the tank picking actually picking one up, but I think they were just playing around.
Well, we will see in a minute. But Unity, are they already playing their special tactics too? Are they on their last legs? Are they taking Lemmeting very seriously, pulling out their best moves? Maybe some of the previous battles where they lost or got very close to winning and didn't, they weren't reserving their best tactics, assuming they could just pull out with standard play. And here's where they go, like, okay, full steam. And they've reserved it for Lemmeting because they realize that this is the moment now. And if they don't pull it out now, they're going home and they don't want that.
The WZs were a bit strange to bring two of them. That was a special strat. Both teams kind of bringing something odd, and they're kind of using that blind pick to their advantage. In America, we don't have the blind pick. Everyone picks with a timer. So I'm Lemming Train and Red Rich Unity, though, are both used to this meta. I'm not as used to seeing how this plays out, what their mentalities are.
But the beautiful Winter Himmelsdorf, where the snow is always falling, that is where we're going to find out the second battle between Red Rush Unity and Lemon Train, as it is 1-0 currently to Unity. Lemon Train have to fight back here. They do not want to have just one victory, well, one more loss away. So I guess it's time to shout and scream for the Lemon Train, as they need to fight for their survival. They need to be here tomorrow against Unity. And it's 1-0 currently to Unity. Let's take it away on Himmelsdorf.
Looking at the tanks, we have 3 5100s and 2 IS3s against 3 5100s and 2 IS3s. Mirror matchups, this is the most common city map lineup that we have.
Yeah, it's the most, since the 69's heat shell change, it is the most common lineup. Sometimes you get the extra IS3, but this is common. Now, the strategies we see here, very standard again. Heal play and a bit of the West, but they're being very aggressive there on the Lemming Train, I would say. That's very forward movements on the West side.
Yeah, taking a forward position early on before your opponents are loaded. And before they themselves are in a position to counter an out,
this is crazy forward. And Potomaco did take a shot early. This is a huge gamble by them. They are playing special. This is definitely unusual play. This is definitely aggressive, ultra strange tactics. This is not standard at all. Unity setup, look at that. Very standard. These are predict. You can literally say, I reckon they're going to be here, and you would get it right, because this is pocketbook. Oh, okay, this is standard 101 tanks. But Lemming Train, not at all.
Lemming Train does have one. There's parts of this that are predictable. Layout in the west, if you saw the one tank, Potomaco, go out to the west, you know there are probably tanks in, you know, the C and D line area to cover any approaches. But there's one hidden tank, and now there's actually some hill play. Cap one does go down to Elian.
Nice shot there by Elian, clipping him out. Antich, though, didn't run away and decided to take down Carmen too. Now, normally, the Antich would have ran, but he decided that, no, I'm not scared of Elian. I'm going to actually do some damage to him instead. But no, Antelis receives a hit, and Elian gets away scot-free. But Carmen did go down. That's an unusual thing. The 5100 usually runs from the hill if they assume there's a play by the other team. But Antelis was sensible. He knew that it was just Elian. He knew he was just one versus one, and he didn't need to run as early as he did. So that's really intelligent play by Unity, but a great play there by Lemming Train.
Now, there's 1 T1 apiece for both teams. At this point, I think it would be wise for Lemming Train to get their T1 back out of its current position and try and redeploy it on the east where they just won with a T1. We already know that Red Rush Unity's T1 is in the west. I believe that was spotted in the opening run, allowing for one of the IS3s to put a shot onto Potomaco.
But one thing I'm worried about, Elian is not reloading. The Antelich has almost finished his reload, and Elian still hasn't even started his.
Interesting choice. You want to hold your shots sometimes if you think there's some kind of counterattack coming, or if you think that you're going to get a chance to get one more free shot out or something of the like,
but
before you have to reload.
This is the other thing that Lemmetry did badly last time. They kept the guy on the hill for too long. And look at this. Elian is still on the hill and deciding not to do anything.
There's a chance, though, that one of the IS3's Rhino spotted on the G-line may take fire from the hill if he stays there.
Well, there is some damage going on. It's Diodor and Antelich are both damaged. Obviously, Antelich got damaged by Elian, but Diodor, I'm not entirely sure where he received the damage.
It must have been Potomaco. He's fired once, and he's done 297 damage. And there was the one hit. And he does have actually Binox on his 5100, so he's seeing rather far for a heavy tank. We usually don't see that kind of stuff.
That's clearly what he is trying to do. He was destined for this position. They customized his tank to fit the job that he's going to do on this map. This is the sort of level you need to go into if you're going to work at this level. But Snip goes down. That's another tier one gone. So both the tier ones are gone for Lemon Train. So they're a bit hampered by their vision. And that does mean that Potomaco is trapped.
Yeah, and also Butcher has been spotted in the east on the 8 line, and he's going to be forced to back off, revealing the fact that their Lemming Train is incredibly split out. We had the one tank spot on the hill, now there's the one spot on the 8 line, and the one all the way in Echo 1 in the west. That is so spread out that you can't possibly support that easily.
I'm surprised that Unity have not used this to their advantage yet, because they do know exactly where all the Lemming Train are. So they should have the advantage, but they're not using it.
Well, if you look at Red vs. Unity's layout, it is perfect southwest defense. I'm not one to believe in the southwest defense as much as a southeast defense or taking the hill when you're on the south side, but the lines of fire are just flawless. You've got one tank looking north of the 1-2 line, you've got two tanks ready to shoot to the southeast approach to the cap, and then you've got two forward tanks that are along that G line, just looking north and east. It's a beautiful setup for Red vs. Unity. It's very difficult for Lemming Train to assail this position.
And they do know that they're one game ahead. They don't actually need to be aggressive. They can make sure that Lemming Train have to be on the back foot. Now, with their T1s down, there's a good chance that Lemming Train do not want to this engagement to happen. We're about to hit the 5-minute mark. We'll see if there's a reshuffle in strategies going to happen with these teams. But right now, it's a bit of a face-off.
And with it being a best of five, Lemming Train can't afford a draw. They can afford to say, you know what, maybe we're not in the best positions to take on Red vs. Unity right at this moment. We can sit here and we can think about our next map, which is Prohorovka, and they could be strategizing for that, but they are still trying to work for something. Butcher is moving out, and after he was spotted on the 8 line, he backs off. Red vs. Unity says,
Butcher has to be careful, as Rhino could easily get that massive shot onto him. That big gun on the IS-3 can do a ton of damage, but Rhino receives the shot. Butcher does receive the return shot and is tracked. It's a lot of danger for him, but he can unload into Rhino, and if there's no one supporting Rhino, that is a great move by Lemming Train.
Beautiful. Rhino is down to 622 hit points. He fires in return. It does not hit anything. Ilian now is looking at 5100 off in the southwest, but no hits yet. He's lining up for another one, though.
This is dangerous by Ilian. I don't agree with this maneuver because they do know that their Peito Mako is trapped. So there's a good chance that Unity now are going to move in on him. And they know that one of the 5100s is on reload, Butcher, and they know that Ilian is randomly firing, unless they think that Butcher was just unloading the rest of his clip. But that's something that they have to be careful of, because right now, Lemming Train is so spread thin. If Unity attack in one direction, there's a good chance they can get the upper hand.
Yeah, Unity, if they push, though, they are leaving their cap exposed, and they have to be conscious of the fact that there are two 5100s possibly in their backfield that could fast cap them. And they could just probably just leave one of their tanks behind to defend. That would work out fine. They'd have an overmatch still 4v3. But I believe I was talking to Woosa.
Peito Mako receives a shot on the side. He's got to be careful here as he's going down to a one-hit kill, but he gets back into cover in time. Dardor, though, is receiving a lot of damage too. The HP value here on Unity is quite low. Lemming Train is actually higher, and Rhino is in a lot of trouble. He can actually get one-shotted here with any sort of high roll.
I mean, Rhino just actually fired into snow. And just, I don't know exactly what he was looking for, but...
Maybe he wanted to see if he was spotted?
Or he wanted to watch the snow just kind of poof up in the air.
It is pretty.
Yeah, it is. This is a pretty map.
But the big move is happening with Butcher and Ilian coming around the back. They got to be careful because they are still on reload for another 10 seconds. Antelich and Lusik are... Well, Lusik's on reload too, actually. This is worse for Unity because he is going to be reloading as Ilian goes across and spots them. And if they decide to engage, Lusik can offer nothing. However, they decide not to engage. That's going to give Lusik enough time to reload. And this is big. It's all down to the seconds now. As Lemming Train is counterattacking from the north, and that means Unity have to defend from all directions. Can they do it? This is going to be critical and down to the very fine wire as player skill will come to the max.
And now Meritorious is against Nuclear. The two of them are proxy spotting and just squaring off, pinning each other in these positions, while Butcher is taking on the 25100s in the southwest.
But it's not going to work out for Butcher. One more shot, he goes down, but Lusik goes down to a very low HP for exchange of that. Ilian needs to move in with Meritorious. He needs to get around and take that shot and take him out. Nuclear goes down, and he needs to take out Rhino very quickly, because if they don't take out Rhino, they could fall down on the other flank as Ilian is in trouble. As he only has two shells left, he will go down, but he needs to take that shot. Will he take it? No, I'm not sure actually. He might have got off the exact same time he died.
At the same time, Rhino is down. And with that, two
tanks. Three versus three. It's still 3 versus 3, but the HP is low. One shot still for Lucic. He is on reload. Antelich, 3 shots, maybe 4. He is on reload too. Diador has 2 shells remaining. 478. 2 shot. Potomako, 71 HP. But the other two guys, IS3s, with still quite a bit of HP. However, they can't engage them. The 5100s are going to run away. 1:20 on the clock. Lemon Train have to be careful. If they are too defensive for too long or chase them, they won't be able to do it in time.
Well, Nipazoni is predicting the 5100 retreat perfectly. It's just his timing that is ever so slightly off. In the west, though, Diador does look like he's going to hunt down Potomako, but Potomako is ready for it.
This is going to be very close. Oh, he doesn't do it. He doesn't get the shot. He was looking the wrong way ever so slightly. Enough, though, his reaction was quick enough to get back out of it. In the other side of it, though, the IS-3s are deciding to engage, but he's been gone. He got trapped. That's disastrous. And Diador wins on the other side. And now it's up to the Lemon Train to actually go for the draw, but they messed up the attack. Unity are your winners. Lemon Train, confusing there at the end, but they engaged poorly. And the 5100s are one side of you and the other, you don't know who to look at. You go around the corner, you look at one, and then he hides. Then the other guy comes out, you look at him, and he hides, and then you're dead.
The tiniest little misread. He was trying to predict the retreat of those 5100s, but one of them got a little bit farther than he had expected, and with that he walked himself into a crossfire. Both 5100s having shots on his back and front same time. It looked like he fumbled with it. He was confused. He was like, oh my gosh, there are two 5100s here. I expected them to be further to the west.
He thought they were going up the hill.
I think he didn't think they'd be that far to the east. One of them had made it that far. And
one is already crossed. So exactly. He was looking one way, and then he came out, and he got confused.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And he was actually hammeracked in the first shot, which didn't hurts help. A lot. Yeah, that really doesn't help.
His Repeket was surely gone by that point in the battle, but it was really close. Lemon Train proves that they got what it takes to take down Unity. It was super close, within one or two shots of actually making the difference. The timing was ever so slightly out. As I said, before the battle engaged, it was all down to those milliseconds. If they came around the corner a bit too slow, which is what they did, they didn't engage the two tanks that were on their own with three or the four. Elian got caught out, and by the time Elian died, they were still defeating the IS-3. And they just did at the same time, but they should have been there to back up Elian. When Elian died, they should have been there, just as Elian died, to follow up and clean up, or at least try to.
Exactly, but then the second engagement was where I thought the IS-3's late game would be more effective, simply because there's a smaller health pools, and the high alpha of an IS-3, a good roll in any of those 5100s is dead, whereas with those healthy IS-3s, they still had enough to the point where they could take a little punishment from a 5100 in order to just get that one necessary shot to finish them off.
The IS-3 should have gone in together, though. That was another mistake they made. They went in one by one.
Always have a battle buddy.
Yeah, they should always have a battle buddy, as you said. But they they were together, but they were just too far apart. They were impatient. The timer was running low, and they thought, it's definitely a draw, at least a draw. We can't lose this, but we're going to go for the win. And they rushed. And when they rushed that little bit too fast, that's the end of that.
Yeah, well, they were trying to catch them before they reloaded. 5100's reloading, they're, vulnerable. And, of course, they didn't reload, I think. They were actually loaded just a few shells short.
That is the problem, though. They were not fast enough to catch them on the reload. They actually waited for a bit, and then moved forward, and then waited a bit. So they were... See, this is actually an argument I would say. They hesitated only slightly, but not enough to redecide. We're going to hesitate and wait to go in together. Or we're going to go full on and just try and catch them out. But they didn't do either. They hesitated and then split up and then hesitated a bit more, indecisive, and died. And you can't do that. You have to have a decisive plan. Like, okay, let's just go chase them and they're on reload. Let's get them. Or let's hang back, regroup, go in together and do this methodically. Because as you said, two IS-3 shots could have killed either of those tanks.
Yeah, one IS-3 shot would have killed one of those 5100s.
Well, there you go. So if one bounces, the other one would definitely kill them.
Exactly.
And that would have been what they needed to do. But they went in one by one, and excellent play by Unity. That's where the veterancy comes. One's hiding one side, one hiding the other. You look one way, the other guy comes out. You look at him. The other guys, oh,
see, those are battle buddies. 250-100s working together.
That was perfect. I've got to say that they were outplayed skill-wise with the two tanks, two versus two there. It was definitely outplayed. On the other side of the field where Potomaker, was it, was there, he didn't get outplayed. He just had less HP. Well, simple as that.
He probably could have done a little bit more damage, but his opponent was a little faster on the trigger and got the shot off before he was able to return anything.
Yeah, the Antlish managed to do a near 2,400 damage in that last battle, really doing a good job for Unity, but many of the Unity guys had really high damage because of how long that brawl happened, and three guys alive at the end obviously did the most damage, the 5,100s. Yeah, you're right. If he was looking just 2 meters more to the left, he probably would have got the first shot off, backed into cover. Then it would have been like the Elian moment.
Ideally, what you want to do is you want to get that track pen, a shot that simultaneously tracks your opponent and still penetrates
past. Spins them.
Yeah, and that'll throw off a shot sometimes if they click exactly at the moment.
Yeah,
you've had that experience.
Oh, when you get tracked at the moment you're firing and your shot just goes up into the sky.
Yeah, and you're just like, oh, why did I click? I knew it was going
to
happen.
Yeah, but even then, if you track them, by the time they rotate their turret to aim for you, 2.8 seconds have passed, they're firing again and they get you. Or you snap click to try and get the shot, and it doesn't matter anyway. It misses. So the next map will be Prokhorovka. What can you say about this and these teams?
Well, we saw some crazy stuff, those WZ-132s and the Object 416. If we see something like that again, I'm looking for surprises. But if we don't, then probably standard play that we've seen all day on Prokhorovka.
This is the middle play. That's the play we are expecting to see in the middle, trying to use those hills to your advantage and the mobility of the 1390s. But anyway, it is Lemon Train's last chance. They have to win this battle here, or they are going home. So if you like the Lemon Train, you cheer for them, you make sure they know you want them here. But Unity, they're playing so well, they just need one more win and they are going through. So this is all or nothing right now for the Lemon Train.
Looking at the tanks, we have a Pershing, a T69, and three 1390s versus a Pershing, two T69s. And two 1390s. And it looks like both teams are heading towards the middle on this west side of the train tracks.
This is pretty standard. They're going to do the early scouting, but this is where the advantage comes with Diodor here, already being loaded and in a great position to get that early damage. And he gets it. Elian gets that shot. That is always a good move to get. It's never so critical, but every HP can be down to the wire, can't
they,
it?
They already start with more hit points. Redrich Unity has an extra medium tank.
Whoa, look at this play here by Unity. They're pushing up.
Yeah, taking the bowl position in Echo 2, Foxtrot 3. And with that, they will have control of the west side. Lemon Train has to back off or make something happen.
But this fight is going down already as Potomaker goes down to 396 HP. He's a two shot before he will go down. Dardos bounced so many shots, but he's still taking some damage. It looks like Unity are deciding to put Lemon Train on the back foot. They're learning maybe the weaknesses of Lemon Train. They can't defend as well as they can attack. So they are going to put Lemon Train on the defensive. Dardo down to 50%. But as I said, Potomaker's already down to 396. Nuclear is coming round the side. Lusik is there as well. It looks like it's an all or nothing against the Lemon Train as they're Pershing. Sorry, T69 is going to go down. It is, sorry, the Pershing. He is going down. And this is a disastrous result so far for Lemon Train. They've got to hold into it, but that's another tank down as Elian is popped off in the distance because he was spotted and in the open. You can't have that in these open maps. As the battle continues, as the other Pershing is getting gunned down, Lusik is still alive somehow. Cap, the T1 was a distraction and he goes down, but this has to be some excellent crossfire from Lemon Train if they're going to stay in this, because every single combat tank is still alive. But Dardor is down to 212 and he goes down. Potomaker's making it happening for the Lemon Train here, but there has to be some miracle plays as Lusik goes down to 114. That's the T1 doing the damage, trying to make his teammates survive. And this is still going down to the wire. Butcher is the last guy left. He's surrounded at all sides with just one shell left. He will not be able to kill Rhino as Nuclear is going to reload very shortly. He will not have enough time to get out, so it's all down to Potomaker. It's gonna be very, very tough for him.
And oh, he misses it. Rhino misses a ram onto Butcher, but
the
Nuclear takes the shot.
There it is. So it's down to Snip and Potomaker. This is their absolute last chance. Antlish, though, will reload first, and There it is. There's the damage. The last hope is Snip. Can he get the cap or any sort of damage off? But it looks hopeless. Just this poor little T1, the last stand of the Polish team, Lemming Train. Shoots into the sky, sign of surrender.
Or a salute to his opponent.
Or a salute. There we go. GG. Unity 3, Lemming Train 0. Unity are your winners. They go through, and Lemming Train, as great as they've been, go home. They don't have far to go, unfortunately for them, but they are absolutely outstanding. Give a round of applause for Lemming Train and your victors, Unity, as they have played amazingly over this entire tournament.
I think they're chanting. What are they chanting?
Lemming Train. It doesn't matter that they lost. They have provided so much entertainment and they have gone so far and overcome so many odds. It's just absolutely astounding. I cannot believe that they done what they did. No one looking at this tournament sheet was going like, these guys will easily get through, and they didn't easily get through, but they did it. They got all this way. They even managed to face Na'Vi, and that was the end of that story. So,
But Red vs. Unity started off a little shaky, right? And they've gotten so much momentum now. They're looking much better than yesterday. I'm really confident now in Red vs. Unity.
Yeah, Unity started off incredibly weakly, and actually I was watching the games going, how can they do anything? Lemming Train's going to destroy them if they meet them because they're playing so much better. But then every game that Unity have, and there they are on stage. Lemming Train, the heroes of Poland. They doesn't matter that they lost. They've done their country proud. They were a wild card. They were not even here as a seeded team. And they've gone so far, beating so many seeded teams. Absolutely fantastic performance by those guys. But yeah, Unity are gaining strength with every battle. And they are scary, very scary. And well, whoever wins of our next battle, which will be Fnatic versus PvP Super Friends. So our Asian teams with Batman, if you guys know Batman, he will be on stage soon. And Fnatic, obviously a great team from North America. What is going to come from that match to face Unity next? Unity, although, are scary. Even so, that if they keep growing in power, they might even be able to challenge Na'Vi at this rate.
That is quite
a statement.
That is a huge statement. I'm not sure I can agree with that wholly yet.
Well, I don't know. As I said, they're growing in power. They got to keep going. They've got another match to play yet, well, two, before maybe they'll be facing Na'Vi. Because, obviously, we have Na'Vi versus Virtus Pro tomorrow. And whoever loses of that match will be facing whoever wins of Unity versus whoever wins of Fnatic and PvP Super Friends. I hope that made sense. It did to me. Anyway, Lemming Train are on stage and celebrating with the crowd as they are hugely popular with the people here. And as you can see, the crowd is gathering around their players, and I think they're a bit distracted now.
They really are beloved. It's great. When Lemming Train was playing earlier today, the line outside was so long. Everyone was waiting. The queue was...
They couldn't even get in.
It must have been 100 people.
It was absolutely... If it was tickets to be sold, it was sold out. You know, it was just absolutely packed in here, and everyone absolutely adored them. And I love the uniforms. It was custom made. They haven't got a big sponsor. The name on the shoulder is fantastic. Their logo is cool. And just the whole design of it. And it was done by one of their players, I believe. It wasn't even sent off to a professional designer. It's a really good shirt. I've got mine. And I'll be wearing that proudly after this event for sure.
I'm jealous. I got a Fnatic jersey, though. They gave me one of those.
That's very good. But you've had enough of us. Let's go talk to the Lemming Train on the stage.
Thank you, guys. I'm here, obviously, with Moonkiss from Red Rush Unity, obviously their manager, after their victory in that game. And I just want to ask you briefly, from you guys, we've seen a lot of what seems like confident, aggressive play. Now, it's not like some of, like, for example, Na'Vi have been slower. We've seen also, you know, some of the other Russian teams in the past especially play slower. Do you think that you're a slower team, or like we saw so much aggression from you? Is that just because you're feeling confident, or is that just how you play?
Okay. The first game was on mines, and it was like special tactics, special tricks. And the team decided where to show this setup, this lineup, and this tactics. And they decided that it is the right time to play like this in this match, because it was really important to win the first game. That's why we played the first game really aggressive, and because it was like I don't know how or something like this. And one more. The second game after we won first game, it was an easy for us to play next games, because according to rules we could play even draw, and it was okay because we will get 1-1 for each draw. So it's really important to win the first game, the first match. And in the second game, it was on Winter Himmelsdorf. Lemon Train, they did something crazy. I don't know, something weird. And that's why it was not a really hard game. Okay.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Moonkiss, and I'm sure you'll be celebrating with the rest of your team. Thank you. Another round of applause, of course, for Red Rush Unity now advancing to tomorrow's day of play. And now, ladies and gentlemen, of course, we aren't quite done here yet. We want to see what the analysts have to say about this. Guys, Clutch, tell me, what's your take on this one?
Thank you, Uber. Well, our take right now is congratulations to the Red Rush Unity, but also a very special congratulations to Lemming Train. They were the main story thread that was happening here at this event, but the Polish crowd is now going to see if the victors will be from America, from Southeast Asia, Europe, or Russia. Well, pretty much Russia, First Pro and Na'Vi. Gentlemen, first game, Minds, what was Alien doing? Why? What happened? YOLO mode? Too much from Alien?
Maybe. Maybe he lost his concentration, and the picks, the tanks that both teams picked, they were so unorthodox. Maybe they just didn't know what to do. It was a really weird game overall. And of course, after that, maybe Lemming Train just panicked a bit, and Red Rush Unity, they went with the WZ-132s to the hill, and then they just dropped onto them and just crossed them after that.
And it was a very nice cross that they made on the east side, and that's when east is applicable. That's when you want to use the east, when you have an advantage maybe by a tank kill or some sort of HP advantage, and then you move those two tanks and they start to push that flank. And that's what's really crucial in that battle. The Object 416 position, not the best position where it was. It has no tank depression.
No, it was absolutely not the best position. I mean, he's driving to the hillside without any gun depression. So maybe he was a support if they take the hill to continue and drive up. But yeah, in the beginning, he was basically useless. He couldn't really help the team.
Yeah, it is unfortunate because that tank has proved to be very, very useful ever since it was first added to World of Tanks, and teams were using it a lot in Season 2, at least for the North American League. Okay, Himmelsdorf, mirror matchup, 5100s, three of them, IS-3s. Butcher takes the high ground along with his battle buddy, but it became the one-on-one and the 2v2v2s. And a lot of the firefights that were happening between these teams, between these tanks, was one of them would bait them out and the other one would wait to get the shot and then focus that fire on one tank first and tank it out before the second one. Reminded me of Jurassic Park. The one raptor is kind of like the distraction, and then this two, three, or four, whatever hunting pack is ready to pounce on whatever the distraction is.
Yeah, actually, in this game, we saw the individual skill of the Unity players, because Potomaco was dueling Diador in the train tracks. Diador won that battle. Then it was the two versus two, two pairs fighting, and Unity came on top in both of those fights, actually in all three of the fights going on. So the personal skill came out on these battles.
And also the positioning too around those corners.
Yeah, of course.
We could also add Butcher didn't really move well. Yeah. He went out and died alone out of position again.
Okay. He rises and falls. Yeah,
Lemming Train had an opportunity, but they didn't know that Lucicul was loading up his magazine with the 5100, and Alien and Butcher, they could have gone on and killed them, but yeah, I don't think so. Yeah. They knew that he was reloading.
I think one key as well in the same situation, Alien decided to help the IS-3s against the two IS-3s, yeah. But Rhino was already a one-shot, so basically the two IS-3s from Lemington should push around, kill Rhino, and then focus two on one the last IS-3, so they don't need Alien's help, and Alien basically let the second 5100 die in the church in the cap area, two on one against the guys from Unity.
He just went in that street like no one is there, and he got shot, Alien or not, he would die anyways.
So is the breakdown by the individual calls that were made in those 2v2s, or was the breakdown from the commander not being able to pinpoint.
I would say at the end, again, LTR was a bit split on the map, and Unity was more compact and therefore more effective in those moments. Yeah. Shades decided, really Shades. It was a close match, and I think that is where the balloon of LTR just blew off, and I didn't see that much commitment on the third map.
It was not really the tactic we decided, just the individual skill was slightly in favor of Unity, and maybe a bit outplayed in some situation. It was not really the big plays, but the slightly ones who decided the game in the end.
And it's a lot of small windows and personal battles that these players will have that'll determine overall the bigger picture. Prohorovka, though, was a straight shootout. I mean, it was taking the bull, landing the shots, then initial hits where Alien peeked over the hill, boom, goes back down. I mean, those initial firefights that happen with those small HP victories is crucial later in the game. I don't see anything more than that.
Such tactics on Prohorovka are not played randomly. They're played by spawn. It's very important how team is spawned. You can decide, therefore, should you go left or right? Will you push that trench on the middle or not? Definitely, Unity got spawns for the right side and said, guys, we're doing this, we're pushing this hard. And they just executed. Lemming Train was caught on several different spaces, on open, even worse, and they were just shot off.
And it pretty much looked like that Fatigue was getting Lemming Train at that point.
I think the Himmelsdorf was like the final drop. They didn't play this well. This map was not played with heart.
Exactly. Also, they missed on the city side. They got the honor and control, the 3090 going up to the north to flank Unity and shoot them from behind. And they missed it. So maybe they already say, okay, I'm not sure if we can make it, so let's keep it, try something. But yeah, normally if you play it on 110%, you have to go to the north, try to flank from behind, split over the whole time, play cooldown. And they played a bit too aggressive, lose too many hit points in the beginning, and then Unity just decided to push over.
I mean, they also had a potential nice play on the east by sending the T1s at least to scout out what was actually happening to the north. Yes, it could be a gamble, but if you send that T1 over the railroad tracks to the north and you don't spot anything, that way you can understand, okay, they're either pushing towards that bull or they're using the western space. And if they're using the western space, we may have some more flexibility closer to those railroad tracks. That wasn't the case. Red Rush was pushing straight to that bull, and they had two of those tanks.
They didn't wait a second.
No, they didn't at all. They had two of those tanks next to the railroad tracks, and they were way too late to start the engagement. And because of that, it was just a piecemeal. They took them out.
And they could afford to play so aggressive. 2-0, they had
nothing to lose.
They had nothing. This was like, if it works, if we meet them, if we do this hard enough, we won. If it fails, okay, we can lose the game. If they're not there, okay, we're going to control this side of map.
Well, congratulations. Congratulations to Red Rush. Yeah. Unity. They continue in the series.
Finally deserved something.
Finally deserve. All right, we'll see if they'll continue to deserve their wins if they face the winner of Fnatic or PvP Super Friends.
This is a known scenario for them. They came more than once from loser bracket, so we will see.
They're used to it. Used to fighting.
I guess they wake up from when they can't fall over, something like that.
They kind of like the scenario, right? They like to climb back up.
Hey guys, there is no lower down. Okay, let's play.
All right. Well, we're gonna get that next match underway in just a bit. But we want to check in with the social media world. Melly, I'm sure a lot of people had a lot to say.
The community darling has been defeated. The Cinderella story can't be written anymore. That was the last wildcard team, and it's gone. It's sad, the community is sad, and I think the people here on site are pretty much sad as well. And yeah, nothing more to say to that, right?
Okay, it's people are mourning a little bit, but
exactly.
The tournament's not over.
And I want to cheer people up, that's what I'm here for. And I've decided, since our Facebook challenge is such a huge success and the participation of the people at home is just overwhelming. We already have around 1,000 comments under the picture where I'm giving away those beautiful VIP bonus codes. So if you head over to facebook.com/WGLEU, you will see, actually you can go through that together. So if we have a look on my computer, you see I'm on the WGLEU Facebook page, and the very first post for the next 2 days, it will be staying right there. And yeah, the only thing you have to do at home is to tell me why you deserve this VIP bonus code. And we're giving away three of them. And I've decided to put in the Panzerkampfwagen. I haven't talked to anyone from Razer yet, so maybe I won't be here tomorrow. But I'll promise you to give a fourth place prize out, and it will be the Panzerkampfwagen 4 Hydraulik, which you can only get by purchasing the mouse, actually. So you will be the only person, I guess, that has that tank without having the mouse.
Dude, where's your mouse? Like, hey, man, Melly's a special friend of mine. So exactly. I got it. Well, this is why people
I'll
participate.
In there. Exactly.
This is why they watch. Hashtag the grand finals. That does it for us for right now, ladies and gentlemen. But stay tuned. The next battle will be underway in just a little bit. You're watching the Wargaming.net Global Grand Finals. See you soon.